Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on the structure of smooth muscle. The best way to study smooth muscle is after having studied skeletal muscle first, because we learn most of it by comparison. I'll leave links to some of my videos on skeletal muscle in the description box in case you'd like to use them. Smooth muscle is really complex, and in this video, I'm going to try and simplify its structure. Unlike skeletal muscle cells, smooth muscle cells are not striated. That's why they're called smooth muscle. They're also called plain muscles. Smooth muscle cells are spindle-shaped with tapering ends, and they've got a central nucleus. They have been classified as multi-unit smooth muscle and single-unit smooth muscles. Now, the terms single and multi refer to how they contract rather than the number of cells. Multi-unit smooth muscles have cells that are more separate, with their own innervation, so they each can contract on their own. They are better for finer control. These are seen in specific areas of the body, like ciliary muscles of the eye, which contract and relax, changing the shape of the lens. Similarly, the arrector pili muscle in skin, which attaches to hair. These muscles are responsible for piloerection, making hair stand on end in response to when the temperature is cold or in response to fear. Single-unit smooth muscles, on the other hand, work as one unit. These cells are in contact with each other at different points, such that when one contracts, they all do, and they work together by using things like gap junctions. Gap junctions connect the cells and help ions pass through, ensuring that they all contract together like a syncytium. That's why single-unit smooth muscles are also called syncytial smooth muscles. Multi-unit smooth muscle cells had their own innervation. But for a sheet of cells in a single unit, the innervation is usually to the outer layer because it's anyhow going to spread. The nerves in both cases are autonomic nerves. These nerves don't make direct contact with the cells, unlike skeletal muscle, where somatic nerves that supply them branch at their termination, forming a junction between the two. Instead, the axons of nerves supplying smooth muscles have swellings called varicosities. It's these varicosities that form the junction. They have vesicles containing the neurotransmitter. When an action potential arrives, the vesicles fuse with the membrane and release the neurotransmitters, which then act on their receptors on the smooth muscle cells. The gap junctions ensure that the depolarization spreads through the whole unit, because this is a single unit smooth muscle, and these are diffuse junctions. This is versus multi-unit smooth muscles, where the cells have few to no gap junctions, so the cells contract more independently. It's not as well structured as the neuromuscular junction of skeletal muscles. And also in skeletal muscles, the neurotransmitter was acetylcholine, while here it could be acetylcholine, could be norepinephrine, etc. Because remember that these are autonomic nerves. Smooth muscles are involuntary muscles. The multi-unit smooth muscles mainly respond to neural stimuli, but the single-unit muscles can respond to different types of stimuli, like neural, hormonal, and even stretch. Single-unit smooth muscles are more widely distributed compared to the multi-unit ones. They're also called visceral smooth muscles because they are found lining hollow visceral organs, like the bladder, the ureters, the uterus, the digestive tract. If you think of the ureters and the gastrointestinal tract, you've got an obvious function of smooth muscles here, and that is peristalsis. So smooth muscles are important for peristalsis. Blood vessels also have smooth muscles in their wall. They form a part of the tunica media in the vessel wall. They can regulate the diameter of these vessels by constricting or dilating them. This can change the resistance of the vessels to blood flow. When smooth muscles in the walls of small arteries and arterioles contract, the vessels constrict. That means the diameter reduces, so the resistance increases. If these muscles relax, the vessels dilate, the diameter increases, and the resistance reduces. So just like skeletal muscles, smooth muscles contract and relax. And to do that, they also use actin and myosin, those thick and thin filaments. In skeletal muscles, these filaments are regularly arranged. That's what creates the cross striations. While in smooth muscles, they're not so regularly arranged. That's why there aren't any striations. In skeletal muscle, the thick filaments have myosin and the thin filaments have actin, tropomyosin, and troponins. But smooth muscles do not have troponin. Remember that in skeletal muscles, it was troponin that starts the show when calcium binds to troponin C and then the cross bridges start forming. So smooth muscles don't have this step. Instead, they've got something called calmodulin, and I'll talk about this more in my video on smooth muscle contraction. The thin filaments in skeletal muscles are attached to the Z lines. Instead, here in smooth muscle, actin attaches to the dense bodies. These are both on the surface of the cell and inside the cytoplasm. So in smooth muscle, the dense bodies are like the equivalents of the Z lines. If we assume this is an actin filament, it attaches to a dense body. There isn't much myosin in smooth muscles as compared to skeletal muscle, but they are still distributed between the actin filaments. The mechanism of contraction still involves the sliding of the thin filaments over the thick filaments and shortening of the muscle. The contraction itself still requires calcium. The difference is in the source. In skeletal muscle, the source of calcium is the storage center, the sarcoplasmic reticulum. But in smooth muscle, the sarcoplasmic reticulum is not very well developed. The smooth muscle membrane has these cave-like depressions called caveolae. These are associated with the sarcoplasmic reticulum tubules, but it's clearly not as developed as skeletal muscles. The caveolae are functionally like the T-tubules of skeletal muscle. So they are associated with the sarcoplasmic reticulum and control the release of calcium. But the main source of calcium for smooth muscle contraction is the extracellular fluid. When calcium in the sarcoplasm rises, that can cause the muscle to contract. And that is the structure of smooth muscle. And in part two, we'll look at how these muscles contract and relax. I hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.